In our first video in the series on responsive web design, we explored media queries. Today, we will take it a step further and dive into the world of container queries in CSS. These allow us to create more precise and context-aware responsive layouts by adapting the design based on the size of individual containers instead of the viewport. Make sure to subscribe and ring the notification bell if you haven't already. This is Optimistic Web, where we explore the world of CSS and front-end development, one step at a time. Before we get into the technical details, let's quickly review the HTML we're working with today. It's quite similar to our demo page from the previous video, consisting of a header, a main content area, a sidebar, and a footer. As usual, the style sheet is already set up with the necessary CSS. And this is what the demo page looks like, a typical layout with a content area and a sidebar. Now, if we take another look at the markup, there's a post thumbnail section with three child elements inside the content area. The same code is used again in the sidebar, but this time with two child elements. Whether inside the content block or the sidebar, the markup for the thumbnails is exactly the same. This is a common approach to building component-based web apps, following the principle of build once, deploy anywhere. These components eventually come together to form a complete user interface. On the front end, they appear as yellow-colored boxes, three in the content area and two in the sidebar. Since the content block is wider than the sidebar, the thumbnails appear much larger compared to those in the sidebar. In a real-world scenario, these large boxes could be aligned more effectively. For instance, they could be placed in a row, one after another, to create a horizontal layout. Our first instinct might be to write a media query, just like we learned in our previous video, to update the CSS so the thumbnails align horizontally. This media query checks if the viewport width is more than 30 rem, then makes the post thumbnails CSS class a flex container, with the available width equally divided among the individual thumbnails, leaving a gap of 1 rem. If we test its responsiveness in Chrome DevTools, it seems to work well. The thumbnails align horizontally when the viewport width is wider than 30 rem, and as soon as the width drops below that threshold, the layout shifts to a columnar setup. There is nothing wrong with using media queries and relying on the viewport-based approach to adjust the layout. However, since the same component is used in the sidebar, and because the sidebar is also affected by the viewport-based breakpoint, this leads to unexpected changes. The thumbnails in the sidebar now appear tiny. To address this issue, container queries can be used to specifically target the parent container and adjust the layout based on its width rather than depending on the overall viewport size. To define a container query, we first need to establish a containment context. We can do this by using the container type CSS property on a parent element to let the browser know that we want to query the dimensions of this container. In our case, the content area or the sidebar can serve as a container for their respective child elements. The container type CSS property accepts one of three values: normal, size, or inline size. Normal is the default value, size is for container size queries in both the inline and block dimensions, and inline size is for container size queries only in the inline dimension. If you're not familiar with the inline and block keywords, I recommend checking out this in-depth video on CSS logical properties. In a nutshell, the inline keyword is used for the horizontal axis, and the block keyword is used for the vertical axis. This makes inline size similar to the width in a horizontal writing mode, while block size is similar to the height. In most cases, the container type property will be set to inline size. And then we can use @container instead of @media to define a container query. This query block will now check the width of the parent element, whether it's the content block or the sidebar, and if the width is greater than 20 rem, it will convert the layout to horizontal mode. This slight update to the query mechanism has resolved the issue. Since the width of the sidebar is less than 20 rem, it shows a vertical alignment of thumbnails, while the content block, being wider than 20 rem, displays the thumbnails horizontally. If we test it again, the layout now perfectly responds to the width of the parent elements instead of the entire viewport. In addition to container type, there's another property we can use to target a specific container. For example, the container name property assigns a unique name to a parent element. This CSS code assigns a name to the content block and sets its type to inline size. This allows us to write CSS rules specifically for the content area without affecting the sidebar. And then there is also a shorthand version that combines container name and container type in a single declaration. If you use the shorthand version, you must include both the name and the type in the same order. You can't skip any of the values. Similarly, the sidebar can have its own containment context with a unique name. And now we can add a container query targeting the content block. The only difference in the syntax is the addition of the container name. This query block now checks the width of the content area, and if it's greater than 20 rem, it adds a background color to the post thumbnail CSS class and removes the bottom margins from the individual thumbnails. Notice the difference? The sidebar remains unchanged because we specifically targeted only the content area using the container name. If the container name is not defined, just like in our initial example, the nearest ancestor with a containment context will be considered as the parent element. Suppose the content area is not declared as a containment context, but the body element is, then this query block will look for the nearest ancestor with a containment context, and if it finds that to be the body element, the query will be based on the width of the body. Additionally, similar to media queries, we can use logical operators to combine one or more conditions for the container query rule. In this case, we are checking if the container width is more than 20 rem, but less than 35 rem. This can further be simplified using the range syntax. The query condition remains the same. The width should be greater than 20 rem, but less than 35 rem. And the front end is perfectly responding to it. The background becomes visible only if the width of the content area is between 20 rem and 35 rem. Now let's circle back to the container type property. As mentioned, it accepts one of three values, and in most cases, we only need to work with inline size. Typically, we don't explicitly specify a width for a container element. For instance, a div element automatically stretches to fill the available width, even if it's empty and contains no children. However, height behaves differently. The height of an element is determined by its children and adjusted based on the number and size of those child elements. So when we use size for the container type, we instruct the browser to query both dimensions, width and height. This eventually means that similar to the width, now the height of the container is also independent of its children. In simple terms, the child elements will not influence the height of their parent container. Let's verify this in DevTools. As you can see, the content area no longer extends its height based on its children. The child elements are overflowing beyond the parent's boundaries. However, if you have a use case in your mind where you need to write a container query and adjust child elements based on the height of the parent, you can use size as the value for container type. In that case, you might need to address the issue of overflowing children, such as adding a minimum height to the parent or using similar solutions. But it will depend on the specific layout and what you want to achieve. Moving on, there's another aspect to container queries. They not only allow us to query the size of the parent container, but also enable us to check if a particular style is applied. For example, we can query whether a border or background color is applied to the parent container and then update the styles of its children accordingly. However, this is still an experimental feature with limited browser support and currently works only with CSS custom properties. Let's look at a straightforward example of style queries. Since this feature works only with custom properties, for now, we can store the background color in a variable and then use that variable wherever needed. The result will still be the same. We have only replaced the hard-coded color value with a CSS variable. But now we can write a style query to check if a particular background is applied. The syntax is quite similar. We only need to add a style function to specify the query condition. In this CSS block, we are checking if the parent has a specific background color. If it does, then the thumbnails will get a border. And as soon as the background color appears, the border also comes into effect. Similar to the example above, let's create a media query that checks if the width of the viewport is more than 45 rem. If this condition is met, it will update the background and border for the sidebar. After that, we can now base our query on the background color and check if it matches the condition. If it does, it'll change the thumbnail color accordingly. It's also possible to nest container queries. The following query will evaluate to true and apply the declared style only if the container has a background color that matches the specified condition and its width is less than 30 rem. Finally, let's explore the container query length units. When applying styles to a container using container queries, we can use container query length units. These units specify a length relative to the dimensions of a query container. There are different options for length units in the context of container queries. They work similarly to viewport units, but are based on their respective container. For example, VW represents the viewport width, whereas CQW stands for container query width. Other units include CQH for container query height, CQI for inline size, and CQB for block size, and so on. We can use these units in the same way as other length units. In this example, we are using the clamp function to adjust the font size with 1.25 CQW, which equals 1.25% of the container query width. Unlike media queries, which use breakpoints based on the viewport size, container queries allow us to target specific elements and update their contents based on the size and styles of their parent container. While we may still use a responsive grid for the overall page layout, a component within that grid can define its own changes by querying its container. It can then adjust its style depending on the query condition. This opens up numerous opportunities for creating adaptive layouts with components that can be built once and used in various contexts. This concludes our second video in the series on responsive web design. If you found the tutorial helpful, give it a thumbs up, share it with fellow developers, and subscribe for more front-end development tips and tricks. Feel free to leave your questions or comments below. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next one.